I could please call the meeting to order. Okay, can I formally open this cabinet meeting? It's a delight really to be at Birkenhead Town Hall. Change of venue. So thank you for coming tonight, members of the public and members of the cabinet. Just before we get into the business tonight, I thought I would just use this opportunity of the public cabinet meeting just to, for those who don't know, formally announce that Wirral last night was declared the most improved council of the year at the Local Government Chronicle National Local Government nominations in London. These are probably the most prestigious awards in local government. The most improved council is one of the two big awards for tonight, the other one being the Council of the Year. But I wanted to just register that it's a fantastic accolade to have won that nomination and that award. It was quite a challenging process going through the different stages of the awards. To submit a written application. We then had the judges from other part of local authorities came up here to meet with us, and we did a presentation, and then we had to do another presentation yesterday afternoon prior to the evening announcement. So, you know, they are regarded as the Oscars of local government. So I think it really just behoves me to say a huge thank you, really, to particularly our staff. It's been a very challenging 3 years, and we have come an enormous distance. So I would just like to put on record my thanks as a leader to all our staff, because the effort has been fantastic, and as well as staff, obviously, elected members right through from the cabinet to the scrutiny committees, quasi-leadership committees, everybody, all the elected members connected with the council, our partners in the public-private and third sector. It's been a genuine team effort, and I am so delighted that all the hard work has been recognised nationally now. And therefore, I brought the trophy along with me. I shall leave on the front here for people to admire. So, obviously I've written to all staff and thanked them today, but it is just a fantastic recognition, really, of the work we've done. So a big, big thank you from me as leader to everybody concerned. Thank you very much. Okay, with that pleasant duty having been dispensed with, I'll take us to the agenda tonight. Item one is the standard members' code of conduct declarations of interest. Do we have any declarations, Mrs. Burney?
Yes,
I'd
like to show an interest in item 8 and 9, purely because of the relationship.
That personal interest? Yes. Yeah. Okay. And can I declare a blanket interest for all cabinet members in item 11, school governors, the admission arrangements, the usual report we get this time of year? So. Of all cabinet members, so they were all school governors. Okay, anybody? Any other interests? Okay, great. So that takes us on then to item two, the minutes of the last meeting. Can we agree that our sign was a true record? Then to the items the Legal Council. The first item is item 3, the pay policy statement for 2015-16. Don't really want to say anything much more than set out in this report, which is self-explanatory. The pay policy is a statutory document we have to bring to Cabinet and then on to Council on an annual basis. You can see the detail listed in the report, and there's obviously also an issue about the starting salary for our new chief executive. So I just formally like to move those recommendations there. They agreed. Okay, thank you very much. Which takes us then on to item four, which is financial monitoring for 2014-15 month 10, pages 31 to 52. I simply just want to highlight the fact that I'm pleased to see that our overspend is reducing yet further, 770,000 at month 10, 50,000 improvement on month 9, and you know, it looks as though we're on course to more or less balance the books, which is great news. I'm pleased that you know we're still keeping our eye on the ball in terms of the finances, which is excellent. And really just point you in the direction of the recommendations in paragraph 17 on page 42, where we're being asked to note the attendance statement, the changes in budget allocations relating to the reallocation of capital financing, impairment changes, and note the risks relating to non-delivery of savings as detailed in the report, and the continued work to mitigate those non-delivery of savings. So, can I ask that we agree those recommendations?
Agreed.
Thank you. Okay, that takes us then on to the capital monitoring report for month 10, pages 53 to 68. Again, I'm pleased to see that we are continuing to work very hard to try and realise capital receipts, which will obviously be reinvesting in our frontline services. So that's good news that work is going on. Certainly, a big thank you from me to Councillor Adrian Jones for, I know he's very, very vigilant in making sure that we are realising our capital receipts. So I know there might be a few individual projects here that might be worth highlighting, Chris.
Yeah, I'd just like to bring to everyone's attention that we actually, at the beginning up on Monday, the improvements there are just phenomenal. They are absolutely great. And West Kirby is complete. It should be finished by December of this year. The roof's done now, and they're actually working on the inside of the building. The 3G for 4 pitches at Ginnigap, it's lovely to look at them being used now when you look up from the town hall. The other thing I'd like to say is we've also been lucky in getting some capital funding to do the Marine Lane, and we've got Sport England coming along to have a look at how we can redevelop and remake it now and make that a better place. So it's good stuff that's happening at the moment. So yeah, I'd like to say thank you as well.
Yeah, good, yeah, I'll echo those thanks. Stuart?
Yeah, I'll bring Karen's attention to the major schemes system, 326, 327, 328.
That announcement that we've got some of the best kind of road conditions in the country, which was great. So I echo that as well. So well done to all concerned. Chris?
Can I just say that as a senior councillor, I'm doubly delighted really because the Guinea Gap and the fitness suit there is opening on Monday, and it's absolutely fantastic. And the other thing in my ward is Somerville School as well, which now is a really fantastic place for kids to go, you know. And I think we're sticking to our cabinet principles and the looking after people in multiplied areas. I'm delighted.
Great. Okay. Pat?
Yeah, just regarding the infrastructure works in New Brighton, they're 1.3 million of capital money. It shows this administration has continued commitment to New Brighton. And we'll help to transform the seafront. We're in itself, I believe, attract further investments and link up the old and the new and improve access throughout the resource and obviously help to build on the success to date to bring the vibe say it's great news and it shows that continued commitment to the local solution.
Okay, Bernie first.
I was just about to say, this is the holy cross reflection of the council and the hard work that we're doing, and it just shows why we're building the ward. It's in such difficult times, we're still finding positive things, and that we're all are benefiting from the decisions that the council are making. So it's, you know, it's, for me, it just reflects everything, that all the hard work that's been done from everybody throughout the whole of the council. So it's an excellent performance.
Okay, thank you. Bernie, Tony?
Chair, I'd just like to sort of say, particularly in regard to schools and that, and I'll bring out a particular project at Allery Park, £1.2 million of extension. And you might have noticed if you've read the report that our youth school on the Woodchair Fox Field opened on March the 2nd and that. So that was a £12.5 million project of art, sort of our endorsement really of working with children with special education needs and that. Can I just say, also in my own ward, end of primary, because of the huge increase of pupils in that area, to additional courses as well. So, particular thanks to all the officers in the children and the youth department who have really ensured that these projects are taken off, because it's easy to sort of let things slip and that. But we're continually trying to update all the schools and the authority, and this is a great achievement.
Okay, so the Wirral pound will go
much
further.
Yes.
Yeah, well, here to all that. I think that's some really great news in this report. So thanks for everybody concerned. So I'm just going to ask you, can we agree the recommendations in paragraph 18 of this report? Are they agreed?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, that then takes us on to item number 6, which is the creation of a property development framework, pages 69 to 76. Now, I'm going to slightly kind of depart from the usual routine here by asking Kevin, I'm going to put him on the spot, to because this is quite a technical report in terms of the mechanism that we're being asked to consider to get more kind of flexibility around gap funding. So can I just ask you just briefly explain what this is about?
Yes, Chair. Thanks for that. Yes, I think we try and say in the report, Chair, and this was a discussion we had with our investment board and our investment board partners late last year. The situation remains in the Merseyside area, generally in large parts of the northwest, that land values and the cost of construction means that a lot of new schemes are unviable in terms of their end value as opposed to the cost of the land and the cost of construction. In the past, I think Merseyside has been quite fortunate in that we've had significant European funding available to us that we've been able to use for what we call gap funding, so that bridges that viability gap using external funding. I think, as you know, Chair, and I think as members are aware, the final settlements that we seem to have got through the European programme through central government are significantly reduced, and significantly reduces the amount of money that's available for funding to support that gap funding. Indeed, there's just over £6 million available for the whole of Merseyside for the 6 years of the programme, which can be spent on one scheme for us to give us some of the costs. That obviously, Chair, gives us an issue, that issue being a simple one. How do we support businesses to invest in the area, either Indigenous businesses or new businesses, and to invest into new property that they will need to make their businesses successful, to employ Wirral residents and indeed residents from further afield? So, Chair, what this report is trying to do, does do, is give members some different opportunities and options as we move forward. I need to be clear, Chair, by saying firstly, when agreeing this report, I'm not asking members to make any decision except to agree to the concept. Each individual case will be brought for a cabinet member decision. But basically, we outline in the report about how we could possibly do things differently. And one of those is that the council takes head leases. So at the moment, the cost of borrowing for developments depends largely upon the risk that the lending institutions see from the people that are going to actually pay that money back. And as members will be aware, a lot of organisations nationally and businesses have been downgraded in terms of those ratings over the recent years due to the national crisis in the lending industries. However, we as a council still have a very good covenant. So if we were to be the person that actually entered into an agreement with the developer to rent that property that they built, the lending rates would be significantly reduced and then would reduce the viability gap in terms of what the value of the building would be to build and the value of it afterwards. So one of the suggestions I made, Chair, is that we take head leases. So basically we would enter into an agreement with the developer. We would have a legal agreement immediately in place that passed that lease detail on to the business that wanted to occupy that building. So we would in effect be renting, but then rent on somebody else. There would be a payment made to us over and above what our costs were just for the administration of that. Now there are some risks with that, Chair. The risks are that whoever we pass the lease on to actually goes insolvent or goes bust. That would be one of the issues we'd look at as part of our due diligence before we took any report to you. But I think it's a way, Chair, one of the few ways that we can see that we can actually continue to get funding for our businesses to be able to grow and expand and indeed locate in Wirral. So that's one of the things I'm asking you. The other two, Chair, what you're probably more aware of as members. One is that, again, we use some of our own funds where the opportunity exists to actually buy land and to then get that land developed. We did that, Chair, with the development that's going on down, in fact, just over the road at the Lightbox. If you remember, we did that using Regional Growth Fund money. And then there is still a possibility that there would be some gap funding of the £6 million. So again, we're suggesting that there'll be three possible ways we can move forward. We take out a head lease, we buy land or acquire land to get developed, or in some cases we still provide gap funding. Now the reality is, Chair, the council head lease obviously is the most risky of those. I said we would manage that by making sure we do all the relevant due diligence and you would make decisions, as I said earlier, on each one. But in order to manage that risk, what I'm also asking, Chair, is that the £700,000 that's currently in our working neighbourhood reserves, which was retained for this type of activity, we actually use that now as a reserve for the property development framework, hopefully never to be used, but in the event that a business who we then subcontracted or contracted went bust, we'd have that reserve there to cover it. There are other things we do, Chair, obviously by making sure that the buildings that we got developed were relettable in terms of their style, their design and their layout. And basically, Chair, that's what it is. I think fundamentally, I think yesterday again showed, Chair, as well as obviously winning that the award we won, we were also shortlisted for a number of other awards, one of which was Driving Growth and one of which was Entrepreneurial Council. And I think, Chair, this is the way I think you'll find other councils will be moving forward in the future, or those that want to see continued development. So obviously there's financial benefits to us there with new business rates, etc, etc. So a long way of saying, Chair, but that's what the report's.
Thanks, Kevin. So, I mean, for me, the big advantage of looking at this mechanism, it does enable us to retain within Wirral those companies that want to expand. The danger is if we didn't come up with a mechanism like this, they may go elsewhere in the country and we lose those jobs to the borough. So I think this is an eminently sensible kind of policy going forward. And the I think again it is sensible to use that £700,000, which I know other parties wanted to use for other purposes on the budget, So if we'd agreed that, we wouldn't have this contingency fund. So I think, again, it was sensible for us to make a decision to retain this money for this purpose. So I think for all of those reasons, I'm more than happy to propose to the Cabinet that we agree recommendations in paragraph 13, page 75 of the report. So can we agree that they agree? Thank you very much. Okay, so that takes us on to item 7, enterprise zone reinvestment at the business rate uplift. Now, sticking with the theme of asking Kevin to just briefly explain some technical issues tonight, this is another, I think, creative way of getting of addressing that gap funding and the land values issue that you mentioned, Kevin, about using the uplift and business rates. Do you want to just explain what we're talking about here?
Thanks, Chair. I mean, this report follows on to some degree from the previous one. The report obviously outlines some of the policy decisions behind enterprise zones. And one of those important considerations, Chair, is that we as a council, we as a collecting body, retain the business rates uplift in the enterprise zone for a period of 25 years. That's on the understanding that we actually reinvest that business rates uplift into economic regeneration in and around the enterprise zone. There are still decisions that we need to finally clear up with the LEP, Chair, but originally we agreed with the LEP that any development before March 2015 would be shared 50-50 between Wirral Council and the LEP to be used elsewhere. But obviously we're past March 2015 now, so it's in our view now 100% that we will retain. And Chair, this is, again, I think, as you said, quite an enterprising way to see how we can develop it. What we're suggesting in this, Chair, is that we utilise that business rates uplift to create a sort of tax income and finance scheme, where basically we would borrow against that guaranteed business rates uplift that comes into the Wirral Water Development Zone. And we'd borrow that money to develop an investment plan. And again, that would come to Cabinet, Chair, for Cabinet agreements. But then an investment plan would see how we could invest into new developments in the enterprise zone, and similar to the three areas I outlined before, gap funding, head lease and land acquisition. But also, Chair, transport issues. Again, Councillor Whittingham will be well aware that we have some issues surrounding the bridges, which are going to be key to any development at Wirral Water's enterprise zone. And whilst we've got a major transport bid in for those, which I'm extremely hopeful, there still will be a requirement on the council to find resources to put towards that. And again, Chair, I'd suggest that we could use this sort of investment plan and the tax income and finance to do that. I think, Chair, it is something that is getting done particularly successfully, I have to say, in Birmingham, in their enterprise zone, who have, I'm led to believe, borrowed significant amounts of money against their uplift. We now, Chair, I think, very excitingly, have got two major developments, and it's great to see those developments going on now. The new college, one of only a handful of colleges nationally that's actually growing, to see that college site, and also the new office building down at Tower Wharf. So there now are business rates, Chair, that we're guaranteed to get. And again, as you well know, Chair, there are other developments that we're working on that we're very hopeful will come to fruition in the near future. So this report is quite simply suggesting to you, or asking Cabinet to agree that we use the business rates uplift in the way that we need to as part of the enterprise zone deal, if you like, and we develop an investment plan to see how we can accelerate further development and again make the Wirral Waters sites viable for future development.
Okay. And can I just sort of reiterate, really, it's absolutely fantastic to see those two schemes get off the ground in Wirral Waters, in those two projects. People can see the structures now coming out of the ground. So, the Wirral Waters enterprise is well and truly underway, and I'm very confident there will be, that those two projects will be the catalyst for other projects in the next, coming months. So great to see that. And again, I think this is a really creative way of freeing up some additional investment to help that whole enterprise zone come to fruition.
Sorry, Chair, just finally, I also attached to the report Annex A, the enhanced capital allowance of memorandum of understanding. This chair, this is, as you see, is a very formal agreement between the Lords Commissioners of Her Majesty's Treasury. There you go. This is again further good news, Chair, I think, in terms of enhanced capital allowances areas, which we have once we sign this got agreed on the northernmost point of the West Float development. We are one of only four or five nationally that have got this enhanced capital allowances designation on enterprise zones, and one of only two in the north, the other one being a relatively small site over in Teesside. And this, Chair, again, hopefully will give us the advantage where large capital investment that is required by companies, this will allow those companies to be able to get a lot of that investment back in terms of paying against their tax. So again, Chair, this is another, I think, relatively, in fact, very good news story in terms of making our enterprise zone more attractive. But again, Chair, this is just for your information, because we need to sign this formally to get it into law now. And I think Treasury team, we do so before we enter the period of process, which again is why I brought this.
Okay, thanks, Kevin. So you can see the recommendations of 13 about the using the business rate uplift that Kevin has taken us through. To get agreed formal sign off of the enhanced capital allowances that Kevin referred to, and that we have an annual report on the performance of this scheme presented to Cabinet. So can we agree those recommendations? Thank you very much. Okay, so that then takes us to the items of the Adult Social Care and Public Health. Item 8 is the residential nursing fee setting proposal. So Chris?
Thank you, Chris. This paper relates to the annual process of reviewing the level of fees paid to care homes, which is calculated using the efficient Wirral cable model, which we've been using for the last 2 years. The Council takes account of the views of the sector in relation to the actual costs as part of the resetting process, and consultation meetings took place in January. These meetings presented the opportunity for the providers to outline the increased costs and for Council officers to discuss this with them. The views of the sector reflected during the consultation process are set out in pages 95 to 97, together with the Council's response. Section 2.4 on page 94 sets out the revised offer of uplift across each part of the sector, and this section also shows the increase in fees since 2013-14. Increases reflect the cost of care, and whilst small, are to be offered when council budgets are decreasing, as we know. The appendix on page 101 shows how Wirral's rates compare with benchmark SIPFA councils, and I'm asking Cabinet to agree the recommendation that Cabinet support the uplifted fee rates, which are supported by growth in the adult social care budget.
Okay, and I think Chris, you sort of highlighted the graphs which show that generally speaking they're kind of in the mid range compared to other
slightly higher
in some cases compared to our sort of statistical neighbours. So I think we can, you know, that sounds reasonable to me. So members, the recommendation 12.1 that we support the new fee rates as set out in this report in section 2.5. Can we agree on that recommendation?
We agree.
Okay, thank you very much. Right, and that then takes on to another really important report, item 9, integrated health and social care proposed commissioning delivery arrangements for 2015. Chris.
This paper bill sets out how arrangements for the greater integration of health and social care can be progressed further to build upon positive developments and best practice. The aim is to ensure that integrated commissioning arrangements are set in place to improve joint strategic decision making and to build upon the opportunities presented by the Better Care Fund, which pools £33 million worth of health and social care resources. In addition, the drive is to improve service delivery through creating a model for the full integration of health and social care teams to meet people's needs more effectively, responding rapidly and flexibly to support people at home and avoid unnecessary hospital admissions. The key areas for commissioning intentions led by the Director of Adult Social Services are set out in section 2.1 on page 106. And page 107, section 2.5, sets out some of the key options for the integrated community care teams. Importantly, next steps are set out in section 2.6, including key changes to align staffing across organisations. So Cabinet is asked to note the direction of travel and to specifically support the development of a formal management agreement between the CCG and the Council.
Okay, cool. Thanks, Chris. Can I just add to what you said? I think this is a really important report in terms of the direction of travel. The better care fund, much heralded by the government, but actually doesn't bring any new money, which we need to emphasise. So it's doubly important that we use the existing funding that both ourselves and the NHS can bring to the table more wisely, more effectively. And pooling budgets and the other mechanisms described in this report, I think, are absolutely the right way we should be going in. I think as an administration, we are keen to continue this direction of travel as rapidly as possible and look at new models of decision of service delivery around integrating health and social care. So I think this is a really important point. Thanks to you and the officers who've, I know, worked really hard on bringing this to the Cabinet. So can we agree those recommendations?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Right, on to Children and Family Services now. Item 10, Pensby High School's outcome consultation. Tony.
Okay, thanks, Chair. This is about the Pensby amalgamation. In May 2010, two separate Pensby secondary schools entered into a higher federation under a single governing body and head teacher. In autumn 2014, the federated governing body approached the council to begin a formal consultation on the amalgamation of the two schools. Consultation was approved by Cabinet on the 6th of November 2014. A six-week consultation then ran from the 7th of January to the 20th of February 2015, and this included a public meeting on the 21st of January. This was attended by 26 people, and 47 responses to the consultation were received, 40 of which were in favour of the proposed amalgamation, and concerns expressed are considered in the report. This report recommends that the amalgamation proceed to the next stage where statutory notices are published for the closure of Pensby High School revised from the 31st of August 2015 and will describe alteration to the gender intake of Pensby High School for girls from the 1st of September 2015. The statutory notice would be followed by a four-week consultation representation period, which gives further opportunity for consultees to respond prior to any final decision being made. The outcome of the representation period would be reported to Cabinet by the decision makers. And the recommendations are in 15.1, page 119. I'll submit to accept those four.
Okay, thanks, Tony. I think this is I was just kind of reflecting before when I was Cabinet member, there was debates around doing this at Pensby, and there was quite a lot of feedback, but it seems to be general kind of support overwhelmingly for what we're trying to do here, which is great to see. So I'm very happy to support you, Tony. So can we agree, Cabinet, the recommendations in paragraph 15? They agree.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you very much. Right, then on to item 11, the admission arrangements for community and voluntary controlled primary and secondary schools and coordinated scheme for the 2016-17
term. This is just an annual report that we do every year. We're required to confirm the admission arrangements for community and voluntary controlled schools for 2016-17. We're required to have a coordinated scheme for all schools, this includes academies, and general arrangements for admissions, in-year admissions, and fair access protocol. The consultation was held November to January, and no responses were received. A new admissions code was issued by the Department for Education in November 2014, after the start of the Wirral consultation, and the primary and secondary schemes have therefore been updated accordingly. This is to include education, health and care plans, as well as statements of special educational needs. For information, the dates for the statutory coordinated scheme consultation and associated events will occur earlier in the academic year from 2015-16 onwards. For example, the deadline for Cabinet to determine arrangements is currently the 1st of May and will be brought forward to the 15th of March for 2016. And the recommendations are in 13.1 on page 133.
Okay, thank you, Tony. Can we agree those recommendations? Can you? Thank you very much. Okay, that takes us on then to economy, item 12, Birkenhead Town Centre Master Plan Principles. Pat?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. As we can see from the report in the executive summary, the 2010 Integrated Regeneration Strategy for Birkenhead and Wirral Wards has called for the retail offer of Birkenhead Town Centre to be strengthened and to provide a sustainable blend of multiples and independent retailing, including improved markets and retail anchor through either improving existing floor space or through the development activity. As we can see further on, the objective was further strengthened by the Council's corporate plan for 2013-16, including a commitment to develop a master plan for Birkenhead and seek private sector support to ensure its implementation. In terms of the proposals, Chair, looking at to help deliver on this objective, the Council entered into a Stage 1 lockout agreement with Neptune Developments on October 10, 2013, for an initial period of 12 months to allow them the time frame to work up a master plan for the town centre in and around Europa Boulevard, including the site of the current Europa swimming pool. This time frame, you will recall, was then extended to March 2015 to allow further time for the master plan to be developed. The first stage of this master plan has now been submitted by Neptune, which is the contents of this report tonight, and which is the subject of it, obviously. The plan identifies that there is an opportunity to develop both the central and retail core and the leisure retail offer of Birkenhead Town Centre to enhance the footfall of the centre and significantly improve the prospects of the town for future investment across a range of uses. The Master Plan Chair identifies how the leisure sector has emerged from the recession in a far stronger position than the equivalent retail businesses, and demand from leisure operators is generally strong. In addition to this, Birkenhead Town Centre is relatively unusual in that it has a modern cinema complex in the area to be master planned, but this is not supported by quality car parking and restaurant uses, which are essential for its operation. There is, Chair, a synergy between the cinemas and restaurants, which are mutually dependent, as has been demonstrated, obviously, in New Brighton. I'm going to just say as well, Neptune have got a great track record, not just on the Wirral, but across Merseyside and further afield. And when we think of it, they achieved great success in New Brighton. What was basically holes in the ground, what was a testament to icons of the past, when New Brighton was a thriving seaside resource. And really, when you think of it, they've got a much better offer here in Birkenhead, something to actually build on. And I really do think it's going to be a big, major success in the future. Because Birkenhead has so much to offer. If we just go back to the report, Chair, the development of the cinema, as we can see, as an alternative location, will be extremely difficult to achieve due to the stringent value of the existing building. However, the plan recognises the opportunity to utilise the value and investment in the existing cinema and to transform its offer by development of a series, as I said, of restaurant uses adjacent to it, alongside a remodelled and improved car parking offer. This will be achieved by the relocation of the existing Europa swimming pool So the council are buying land on Europa Boulevard and redeveloping the existing pool for restaurant uses. These proposals, Chair, for phase one, for the phase one developments, are deliverable within a short time frame, and subsequent to the confirmation of council's approval to the principles of a master plan on the basis of one, undertaking a test of lawfulness in relation to the master plan principles, two, consultation, this is quite important, which has been promised all along, consultation with the public and businesses concerning the proposals, consultation with staff and trade unions about the potential relocation of Europa pools. And as I say, it's early days yet, Chair, but Birkenhead is crying out for this, and it's long overdue regeneration. Finally, Chair, if all these issues are approved and agreed, it is recommended that the Council enters into an implementation agreement with Neptune Developments to allow the delivery of the first phase of the master plan. Thanks, Chair.
Okay, thanks, Pat. I don't want to really add much more to what you said, Pat, except to say I'm really pleased to see that we've now got a realistic plan to raise the offer, improve the offer. We've got the Town Centre. As we know, it's our main commercial retail centre. It's faced a challenge with Liverpool One, Cheshire Oaks, and other facilities over the last few years, and we need to come up with a formula to raise that offer and bring more investment and footfall into the town centre. And I think this is an imaginative plan. And as you say, Pat, Neptune have got a terrific track record. New Brighton, in the teeth of a recession, was just awesome, really. So, and I think the other thing, just to emphasise, Pat, is at this stage we're just looking for agreement around the principles here in this master plan. And clearly consultation is going to be key with the wider public in terms of what's being proposed, and specifically in terms of Europa, the staff and trade unions around the proposals there. So I think all those safeguards are...
Sorry, Chair, to break the protocol, but just if I can, and obviously as Councillor Hackett said, this is the first phase, and again, we are in discussion with other people about further phases, and we just want to bring members' attention to the fact that last week, LaSalle's, on behalf of the Mars Pension Fund, actually advertised seven shopping centres that are currently in their portfolio for sale. One of them being Birkenhead. That does not mean to say it's going to actually be sold. I have spoken to officers of Mars and LaSalle since that information came out on Friday, and we continue to have discussions with them, because obviously they will have an interest in the town centre and what comes up. We just wanted to make members aware, in case anybody says, oh, we're selling them. Yes, we are aware of that, and we have had discussions about that.
Okay, so members, I'm going to ask you to agree the recommendations in paragraph 13 as outlined by Pat. Can we agree those recommendations? And we look forward to further reports on this item in due course. Okay, that takes us to environment sustainability, item 13, periodic review of fees for scrap metal licences. Bernie?
Administration and the processing of applications under the Scrap Metal Dealers Act of 2013, with effect from the 1st of April 2015. The Council are legally entitled to charge such fees for licences that they consider reasonably, with a view to recover the costs of the administration for the administration of the scheme and ensuring compliances. So, under the provision of the Scrap Metal Deal Act of 2013, the cost of licence must relate to the cost of the licensing scheme itself, and therefore appropriate for local authorities to recover the administrative costs that's associated with this. So a review of the current costs has been undertaken, and it's been identified in January 2015 the licence function will be subject to a 2.2 increase in staffing costs. So cabinets are therefore asked to just approve the increase of the licence fees, the scrap metal licence as detailed in Appendix 2, to reflect the increase in the costs of the administration. So it's a yearly thing, it's just a normal process, so I'd ask you to agree with this.
Okay, thanks, Bernie. So, as Bernie's mentioned, the recommendation 12.1, can we agree that? Okay, thank you. That then takes us to neighbourhoods and engagement item 14, selective licensing. George?
Thank you, Chair. Can I just say that this has been on a long time, I think it's something that is required on the Wirral, and that the Cabinet have approved the draft proposal for a selective licensing scheme for private landlords and a consultation plan on the 6th of November 2014. Proposals covered four small neighbourhoods in Wirral that were showing low demand. Area 1 was Birkenhead South, Area 2 was Edgerton North, Area 3 was Seaton Library, and Area 4 was the Egremont Promenade South. Public consultations on council proposals ran from the 24th of November 2014 to the 18th of February 2015. With landlords, residents and businesses. Over 20,000 people were directly invited to participate in the consultation by an online questionnaire, press release, landlords' newsletters and advertising, website, social media releases, emails and letters, leaflets and postcards to all homes within the boundaries and just outside, one-stop shops provided information on their plasma screens and posters placed in local businesses and shops in different areas. Meetings with residents, National Landlords Associations, Public Service Board and local managing agents. The key finding from those consultations included 607 people and organisations have responded to the consultation. 68.19% of the respondents either strongly agree or agree with the selective licensing proposals, compared to 25.17% who either strongly disagree or disagree. Of the 290 people who said they lived in Wirral, 83.8% either strongly agree or agree with the proposals. In total, 118 landlords and letting agents responded to the questionnaire, of which 60.2% disagreed or strongly disagreed with the proposals. This report details the changes made to the business case for selective licensing, following the consultation including changes to the licensing conditions, changes to the fee structure, as better landlords need less council involvement so we can charge them a lower fee, and increased benefits and support for residents, tenants and landlords to ensure that selective licensing has a real impact in these neighbourhoods. The proposed schedule of fees is set out in Appendix 1. The impact of the scheme will be monitored after each year of the 5-year scheme and a full evaluation will be carried out in Year 4. The Cabinet agreed to declare the scheme on the 1st of April 2015. The soonest the scheme can commence is the 1st of July 2015. There is also a risk that landlords seek a judicial review of the decision to implement the scheme, which could delay the scheme further. The Council is only legally allowed to charge for some aspects of running the scheme. It is therefore need a subsidy of around £193,000 a year for the 5 years, with additional setup costs in the first year of £172,000. Recruitment, redeployment to the post will start once this scheme is agreed by members. A baseline fee per licence will be £695 for 5 years, which will be reduced to £395 for accredited landlords who make an application in the first 3 months of the scheme. Therefore, the recommendations, members are asked to approve the proposal for the designation of selective licensing in the four areas from the 1st of April 2015 and give delegated authority for any final minor changes to the scheme to the Strategic Director of Regeneration and Environment and the Cabinet Member for Neighbourhoods, Housing and Engagement. I shall agree with you.
Okay, thanks, George. I think Kevin, you wanted to add?
Yes, sorry again, Chair, but just a couple of recent, very recent events that I just want to again look at into other country. Cabinet member very rightly said one of the risks is potential threat of judicial review, so yeah. I just want to be sure Cabinet's aware of everything when you make this decision and recommend it to Council. We had an email, Chair, from a landlord, just identified as a landlord, who raised a couple of issues that I just want to clarify again for Council. One of the issues he raised was Section 8.8 of the report, and said it wasn't clear in terms of what we mean. It's where we talk, Chair, about getting increased council tax. The increased council tax is not because we would charge more council tax on houses that are part of the scheme, but we will hopefully bring more empty homes back into use through the through the selective licensing scheme. The other thing, Chair, is he referred to draft orders that were laid before Parliament the week before last that we are aware of and we're aware of. We don't believe those draft orders have any impact upon the proposal that we're asking members to support. Basically, the draft orders suggest that the way we've approached it is the right way. The draft order is saying if an area wants to impose a blanket selective licensing, as some of our adjoining authorities have, they will need to get government support to that first. But if it's less than 20% of the total housing stock in the area, you don't need to get government support. This is less than that 20% of the living this year. So I think, again, that just reaffirms that maybe we're in the same place as government officials in terms of saying we should put it into areas of high need rather than put it across the whole of the borough at once. So I just wanted to make Cabinet aware of that before we make decisions.
And can I say, you know, this was one of our kind of flagship policies in this administration to address the, you know, the age-old problem with, you know, private sector, the private rental sector and irresponsible landlords. And it's great to see us kind of rolling this out now. And I really do wish it all the best. And, you know, hopefully we can, if we make a success of this, we can roll it out further across the Okay, so George, you've moved recommendations in paragraph 13.1. This has to go, report has to go to full council on the 16th of March for approval. So can we agree those recommendations? Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, George. Right, that then takes us now to item 15, which is always a pleasant task, the nomination of civic mayor and Deputy Civic Mayor for 2015-16. Cabinet is requested to make nominations for these positions. So I will, from Chair, formally move for Civic Mayor 2015-16, Councillor Les Rowlands, and for Deputy Civic Mayor, I will also move Councillor Pat Hackett. Are those nominations agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, can I congratulate both Councillor Rowlands and Councillor Hackett? Very good. Okay. I think that's all the business in the public section of the agenda. I now need to move the exclusion of the press and the public, and I want to make it clear that we've got a couple of items that I've got are commercially sensitive, and that's the reason for the exclusion. So, Cabinet, can we agree that exclusion?
Agreed.
Okay. Can I ask